Welcome to all of you joining us for this online service from Motherwell South Parish Church. I'm John Maddock, and I'm standing in this week for our minister, Alan, who's having a well-deserved Sunday off. This is being recorded on a beautiful spring afternoon, and as you can see, the sunlight is streaming down. And that's very appropriate, because the theme for our service today is darkness and light.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Have you ever had a where and when moment? I mean by that a moment in your life when something dramatic happened. It might be in the world, or it might be with your family, or it might be in your own life. For example, if you're my vintage or older, you may well remember where you were and what you were doing when you learned that President Kennedy had been assassinated in the USA in the 60s. I remember. I was in my teens. I was at home. I was getting ready to go to the BB because it was a Friday evening it happened, and the news came over on the radio. Maybe you remember where you were and what you were doing when it was announced that Princess Diana had been killed in that car crash in Paris. Or maybe you remember where and when you were told that there was a baby on the way and that you were going to become a parent. Or that one of your children announced their engagement. Some of these where and when moments are positive, some are negative, but they all stick vividly in your memory. About 3 years ago, I received a phone call on my mobile to tell me that my father, who was in a care home, had been placed on end-of-life care. It was a Friday evening. It was about 7 o'clock. I was on a railway platform waiting on a train. That train was going to bring me home from a medical research appointment in Newcastle. I'll never forget that where and what moment. But for many of us, I suspect, the most recent where and what moment might be this one.
The time has now come for us all to do more. From this evening, I must give the British people a very simple instruction. You must stay at home.
Like many people on that occasion, I was sitting in front of the TV watching the Prime Minister because the announcement had been widely trailed. But the difference was that I was at our holiday caravan near St Andrews. I wasn't at home. We'd only just got it set up for the new season and we had to pack up, close it down and head home the very next morning. And so started the first lockdown, and we've had more of varying degrees over the past year, and we're still not out of the woods. Tuesday, the 23rd of March, is the anniversary of the first lockdown, and what a dark and difficult year this has been. Whatever way you look at it, whatever way you measure it, at least 125,000 people have died from COVID in our country. And to put that into perspective, that's around twice the population of Motherwell and Wishaw combined. The NHS has been stretched beyond its limit at times. The governments across the UK have spent billions propping up the economy. Lots of people have lost their jobs. And the routine health care of many people has been badly affected as screening and operations have been cancelled. But beyond that, everyone has been adversely affected in some way or another by lockdown. Here's what some of our own congregation told me about the darker side of lockdown for them.
The worst thing about lockdown for me was not being able to see people, particularly family. My eldest son Andrew and my sister both live in London, and it was really difficult not being able to go and visit them or them to come and visit me just when we fancied.
I've missed a lot of different things during lockdown. My cousin took a stroke early on in lockdown, and I missed going to see him at his time of need. There was a period, I think August, September, I was allowed into the hospital, but other than that, I was not allowed into the hospital at all. So having to phone the hospital, see things through other people's eyes, that has been really, really tough. But I think the biggest thing that I've missed during lockdown has been church and worship, actually worshipping with my church family on a Sunday morning. That has been a huge loss. Just the vibrancy, the singing, the fellowship, the warmth, I have missed that massively.
The worst bit about the lockdown for me has been not having the ability to spend time with extended family and friends. It's basically been a difficult time personally, and it's hard not having been able to catch up with friends and spend time with my family.
The hardest part of lockdown for us was missing out on a whole year of trips and family gatherings and just all the we should be doing this moments.
Oh, I do like to be beside the seaside. I do like to be beside the sea. I would like to be beside the seaside, beside the sea.
Probably the main thing I miss is my holidays abroad with my long-suffering travelling companion, Janie. We've gone on holiday many years and we make many, many friends abroad, and invariably I come back with a long list of postcards to send and I usually get an acknowledgement. That's what it's all about, getting to know people.
I think many of you will be able to identify with at least some of these thoughts, even if you can't play the piano and sing along with it. Some of us will have had COVID. Others will know friends or family members who have had the virus. And sadly, some of us will know people who are among the 125,000 who have died as a result. But there will hardly be an individual in the land who doesn't know someone who's had to self-isolate, or someone who has suffered loneliness or depression caused by their inability to meet with loved ones, or someone who has been unable to say goodbye to a close friend or relative who has passed away. So this past year has been really difficult. It's been a dark time for the vast majority of the population. On Tuesday, the 23rd of March, there will be a national day of reflection as we reach the anniversary of the first COVID lockdown. Supported by politicians across the country, the day has been mainly organised by the Marie Curie charity. We are all asked to join a minute's silence at 12 noon that day, to honour those who have died and to reflect on the challenges that we have overcome in the past 12 months. At 8 in the evening, there will be another minute's silence, and we're all asked to come together to light up the night. It will be dark by then. Stand outside your door with a light, a candle, a torch, or even the light from your mobile phone, to remember someone who has died and to show your support for people going through bereavement. And there's another, more local initiative. Hamilton Presbytery, at a recent meeting, agreed to support an idea put forward by the Reverend Robbie Hamilton from Airdrie. He's the minister at the New Well Wine Church there. He calls this initiative Light for Lives and asks us all to light a candle in our window to remember at 7 o'clock on Tuesday evening. Robbie has also written a prayer and a lament for Light for Lives, and we're going to hear it now. The lament is sung by Fiona MacDonald from Airdrie to a Welsh tune.
Welcoming God, who in Christ embraced the world in a welcome offered to Jew and Greek, male and female. Hear our prayers for others as we bring family, friends and neighbours, both far and near, to you. As we lament with them in their pain, may they know you drawing alongside them.
Lord, you have been a refuge to all who learn to trust in you, offering hope and help, reaching out anew. At this time of darkness, when hope seems all but gone, may we see again your light to bring in a new dawn.
Suffering God, who in Christ embraced a suffering world and continues to embrace all who are suffering, hear our prayers for those for whom life is hard and at times unbearable, especially over this past year. We pray for the most fragile and vulnerable, broken in body, broken in mind. We pray for the bereaved, for those whose loss has been greatest, unable to say proper goodbyes, deprived of immediate support around them. As we lament with them in their pain, may they know you drawing alongside them.
Lord, you have been a refuge to all who learn to trust in you, offering hope and help, reaching out anew. At this time of darkness, when hope seems all but gone, may we see again your light to bring in a new dawn.
Serving God, who in Christ washed the feet of his friends as a symbol of one who came to serve, hear our prayers for those who have sought to serve and bring relief to those who have suffered and continue to suffer. We pray for all NHS workers and all in the caring sectors, working in hospitals, in care homes, and in people's home. We pray for all who have supported the bereaved in the church and churches, in the funeral sector, in so many other places and other ways. As we give thanks for their commitment, their words and messages of hope, and their practical support, may they also know you kneeling with them as they kneel at the feet of many in need. As we lament with them in their pain, may they know you drawing alongside them.
Lord, you have been a refuge to all who learn to trust in you, offering hope and help, reaching out anew. At this time of darkness, when hope seems all but gone, may we see again your light to bring in a new dawn.
Eternal God, who in Christ pointed us beyond this life to eternity and the place he went to prepare for us, we give thanks for the saints who have gone before us, who inspired us both in their living and their dying. May we be ever thankful for their presence in our lives and that rich legacy of love that they have left and the example they have given for us to follow. In the name of Christ, who is the light of the world. Amen.
So this past year has been really difficult. It's been a dark time for the vast majority of the population. And yet, there's a silver lining to every cloud. I asked the same people from our congregation to tell me what streaks of light they've been seeing during lockdown. No piano this time.
So best bit about lockdown for me has been spending time with the kids. not at soft play, cinema, swimming, birthday parties, all that kind of thing. We've not been able to do that. The best bit about that has been spending time with the kids, walking, just sticking our wellies on, go down the Clyde Walkway, down Barnshawk, etc. That's been the best bit about for me, spending time with the kids.
The best part of lockdown for us has been the fact that we have been forced to slow down and spend some time as a family without just rushing around all the time.
The positive things that have happened, of course, apart from the generosity of the people of the church, are the very kind people who pass and wave to me. And another little thing is someone has put in recipes, and I've started baking. In fact, I've made some tatty scones this morning, John. You're in luck. Would you like to try one?
The best thing that happened to me during lockdown was when my younger son, Scott, his fiancée, Sarah, and their lovely cockapoo puppy, Frank, moved back to Motherwell from Glasgow. I've spent lots of time walking in Daly Estate with Frank. In fact, I've spent more time down there in the last year than I have in the previous 36 years that I've lived in Motherwell.
Every cloud has a silver lining, they say, and for me the silver lining during lockdown would be seeing the way that our church family has responded. It has really been a test of how people reflect the ministry of Jesus Christ, and seeing the way that folk have done that has just been absolutely amazing. You know, folk coming to my own door with baking and hearing stories from people as they go through difficult times, an unexpected visit, a phone call from an elder. You know, so many of our congregation have just gone above and beyond, and it's the simple things, it's the phone calls, it's the visits, it's the flowers, and seeing the congregation do that and actually live their faith has just been an absolute joy. That has been fantastic.
So even in the darkness there's light, and plenty of it. The light of the nurses, the doctors, the auxiliary staff in hospitals, who've worked so hard in the most difficult time of their working life. The light of the scientists who have developed and produced vaccines in record time. The light of countless individuals across the country who've helped neighbours and friends with small acts of individual kindness. The light of those who have donated to food banks. The light of those who have homeschooled their children. So the last year has also brought much darkness, but also much light. Jesus had something to say about light, didn't he? Kay's going to read for us one verse from John's Gospel, but she's going to read it in two different versions with a slightly different emphasis.
First reading this morning is from John chapter 8, verse 12, reading from the Good News Bible. Jesus spoke to the Pharisees again. "I am the light of the world," he said. "Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness." Also from the New Living Translation. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, "I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads of life."
So the light of the world has been with us all the way through the darkness and light of the last 12 months. I hope and trust that knowing that has helped you through these most difficult of times. The light of Jesus has brought us this far. It will illuminate the path ahead. It shines on our road of life. It acts as our lighthouse and will guide us safely to the shore. But as you know, Jesus talks about light in another way in Matthew's Gospel. Here's John to read it for us.
Second reading is from Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, also from the New Living Translation. "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father."
In addition to calling himself the light of the world, Jesus is telling us that we also are the light of the world. And more than that, we've not to hide that fact. We've to let people see the good things we do, not to take the credit or to present ourselves as holy willies, but so that God gets the credit, so that people praise him for being behind our good deeds. Professor William Barclay, our local Motherwell theologian, tells this story in relation to that Bible verse. One of the old historians wrote of Henry V after the Battle of Agincourt, "Neither would he suffer any ditties to be made or sung by the minstrels of his glorious victory, for that he would wholly have the praise and thanks altogether given to God." And Professor Barclay continues, "The Christian never thinks of what he has done, but of what God has managed him to do. She never thinks to draw the eyes of men to herself, but always to direct them to God. So long as men and women are thinking of the praise, the thanks, the prestige which they will get for what they have done, they have not really even begun on the Christian way. So we need to give God the glory as we pierce the darkness, as we let our little light shine in God's world. Amen." Prayer today is an edited version of one which appears in the current edition of Life and Work, the Church of Scotland's magazine.
God of Light, you are in our self-isolating and exercising, in our working or volunteering. You are in our homeschooling and online learning, in our caring and coping with disability. You are in our worrying about job or money. You tell us to stay firm and resolute because of our trust in you to companion and empower us. You are in all our hospitals and health centres, in all care homes and all family homes, in all discussion and decision-making chambers, in all nurseries and education establishments, in all communities and shops, in all our public transport and emergency services. You tell us not to fear or lose hope, even if we are feeling overwhelmed. because you are there in every situation, working for our good. You are there in our anxieties and panics, in our feelings of hopelessness or lack of purpose, in our loneliness and grieving. Because wherever we go in our hearts and minds, you are there, whispering the words of Jesus, "I am the light of the world." God of light, you are in every part of our conflicted and unjust world. Help us to share knowledge and medicine, and lead us through this pandemic.
Ever-present God of light and of love, and yes, ever-present God, even of the darkness. We are all one of your global children. So for everyone we pray, bless us and keep us. Be gracious and look kindly on us. May the light of your face shine upon us and give us peace, your peace. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.
This